All right, well, welcome everybody. Again, we're at the class, the rise and fall of complex societies. Today, our course has been shifted from our usual Tuesday evening course because of the holiday. So we'll continue our lecture talking about the nature of complexity, and then hopefully we'll get into a little bit about some empires and Roman empires as we move our way through the term towards, once we've built these empires and these complex societies, to start looking at the phenomena of why they fall apart and what goes wrong with them. So again, my name is Jay Silverstein, and this is lecture number 5. Which is entitled A Survey of Lost Civilizations, but we won't get that to that until later this week. So with that, let me try to remember to share the slides this time. Looks like we're missing quite a few. Oh, no, we're good. Okay. Can you see the slides okay? So just a review, I changed the readings up a little bit this weekend. So for this coming week, I'd like you to look at Empires and World History, Power and the Politics of Difference, Chapter 1 of that, the Trajectory of Empires. And then Mike Smith and Kathleen Schreiber, two of the foremost leaders in New World Empires. Schreiber looking at the Inca and the complex societies from the Andean and coastal area of South America, and Mike Smith looking at urbanization in general, but with most of his research, and he was my mentor in Mexico, looking at the Aztec Empire, and then looking at boundaries of the state in time and space, transitions and tipping points, and sometimes, I mean, when we're talking about collapse, a lot of times we're talking about these tipping points. We want to know what are those variables that are playing into whatever transformation is happening in a society. And of course, behind me, you can see the destruction of Pompeii, reconstruction of it, of course. And you think about events and like the pandemic that we're going through now and how those could be pivotal points in the future of our society, the trajectory of our society. So it's important, I think, to recognize that a lot of these things, some things are gradual, that they build with time, and some things can be punctuated, exacerbated, where weaknesses become, you know, that you can normally live with, but then under stress that they become devastating. So let's go back and continue our discussion on complexity. And here we're looking at centralized versus decentralized government. I know we talked a little bit about this with the centralized government being focused on the executive power, right? So the center of the political society is focused on somebody, you know, who has administrative control over all the different elements of society. So it's all coming back to the central point, as opposed to a more diffused pattern of government, where you have a central government, and then when you think of federated states, you know, like in America and Russia, you know, that then a lot of autonomy is passed over to the states, and they'll have their own executive officer, and so it branches out, and then that can pass down into different levels of community. So, you know, if you think of somebody who's a control freak, you know, there's the centralized authority versus a more diffuse pattern of authority where you cede a lot of your control to other people to help with the bureaucratic functions with an emphasis on the regional needs. So again, we talked a little bit about chiefdoms and just kind of looking at that growth of complexity in chiefdoms. So if you imagine just at the simplest level, I think I told you the story of a friend of mine who was a prince from Zimbabwe, started off with just his father having one settlement. Excuse me. And then more people come to join and settle within that realm. And so you see that this type of thing can grow, and then you can start to develop a layered hierarchy where you have the central area where the chief lives, and then you might have subordinate areas, and then they might have subordinate areas to them. And so you begin to build this complexity of a governmental hierarchy. And then we'll talk about the relationship of the government to the settlement pattern as well, because they're distinct, but they're also very interconnected. So again, looking at that, how a clan-based, which is often when we talk about a rank society or a chiefdom level society, how that thing can grow into something that's much more complex and with many more layers as it expands. So let's think about the nature of state power, is capacity, the ability of a state to wield power in order to carry out the basic task of providing security and reconciling freedom and equality. So when we talk about the capabilities of a state, what does that mean to you? Let me throw that out to you guys just to comment on. When you think of a state, what do you expect from that state? How do you measure its capacity?
The ability to overcome some crises, like the epidemic, let's say.
Yeah, no, absolutely. You know, and of course, that's the example that's breathing right down us. Of course, every day we have a certain level of capacity. If you're walking down the street, do you feel safe from being assaulted by a criminal? Right? Is the state able to impose a certain level of security in your life? And then when you have a major crisis like a pandemic or epidemic, is the state able to respond? I spent 10 days in quarantine, right? Is the state isolated me? It tracked my exposure and decided that the best thing was for me to be locked up until they were sure that I wasn't carrying the disease or spreading the disease. So the capacity of the state to use the institutions that it has to respond to these emergencies is really important. And of course, as we think about collapse of society, you have to think about the nature of that, the limitations of that capacity. Did people feel in the 1980s with the Soviet Union that it had the capacity to support the society that they wanted to live in? Or was there so much food insecurity and other types of insecurity that it undermined the legitimacy and authority of the state? Is that one of the things that contributed to the collapse of the Soviet Union? What's going on in the United States now? Do people have confidence in the federal government in the United States to respond to the pandemic? I think time will tell on that, but it's certainly in question. And just watching an article today where 7 states in the northeastern part of the United States have formed their own confederation to pool resources to buy supplies to meet the demands for the pandemic, and so that they could share their resources and work and coordinate together, because they weren't getting the support from the federal government. So they formed their own regional government made up of 7 different states, with New York being the centerpiece because its economy is already so enormous. So with a high capacity, you have well-organized, legitimate, able to enforce its own laws, able to respond, a concept. And then if we look at the nature of autonomy, is the ability of the state to wield power independent of public approval. So how much authority does the leadership of your state have? Could the executive branch, the executive officer in America, Donald Trump, do whatever he wants? he kind of got in trouble a few weeks ago for putting his foot pretty deep in his mouth when he said he's the president, he can do whatever he wants, he has total power. And you know, within a day or so, he had to get up in front of the public and say, well, I don't really have total power. You know, he had to backtrack on that. But he tried to make this presentation to the public in a news conference that he could do whatever he wanted and that the states had no authority or power to stop or regulate him. So how much autonomy does that executive branch have? And again, when we think about decentralized and centralized types of government, and we'll talk a little bit more about that, you know, you think about the nature of the autonomy of the different branches of the government to act. Okay, high autonomy, pretty obvious there, and low autonomy, where there's again, that diffusion of power, that more of a decentralized authority for taking action within the state.
Jay, when we talk about the capacity and autonomy, we also have to talk about the external relationships, right?
Well, yeah. And that's one of the things that's actually interesting. Again, you know, in the United States right now is such a wonderful laboratory to look at some of these processes. So, for instance, there were reported incidents where states had ordered personal protective equipment for the people of their state, for the emergency workers, for the medical personnel, and that the federal government seized those supplies when they arrived. So just recently, you saw that this, I can't remember which state it was, I think it was New Jersey, the governor of the state diverted an aircraft loaded with personal protective equipment to a secret airstrip or airport. And then he used the state police and the state militia, the National Guard, to guard that, to prevent the federal government from coming in and seizing the equipment. So the federal government has, based on the structure of the United States, the ability to regulate international commerce. So these supplies were coming in from China. So at one level, they have that ability, and yet now you also see the state thwarting the ability, you know, saying that the government doesn't have a legitimate authority to take those supplies from the state that they had purchased internationally, which is probably more consistent with the American Constitution, even though the federal government has the sole ability to enter into international negotiations. What we're seeing more and more associated with this pandemic is that states like California has entered into private agreements with South Korea and other countries to obtain supplies because they'd lost confidence in the federal government to meet those obligations. So it violates some of the precepts of the Constitution in some ways, but on the other hand, there is the ability of states to engage in commerce and other things like that. So they do have that also the legal ability. But you're looking at that gray area between this authority of the states, you know, the federated components of the country, versus the federal authority of the country, which has the sole responsibility for engaging in international relations, including military action, regulating commerce, tariffs, things like that. So yeah, absolutely, there's that aspect of it. And you see these conflicts going between the components within a complex society, a very complex society, you know, in this case, modern federated nation states versus a simpler society. So again, you know, just kind of expounding on these definitions of centralized versus decentralized governments, a unitary style of government, where you have a central government, and that is exerting authority and legitimate authority over the components of the government. So it has the direct power to regulate the components under it. So, and we'll talk about this as we get a little bit later today into thinking about the nature of these centralized governments, and that you have, in like the United States has 50 states, but then it also has territories and various relations with other places that might fall within the nation. Samoa would be considered, you know, part of the United States, or Puerto Rico, yet they're not states. And so there's these other types of relationships. Hong Kong, which has control of, is under the authority and legitimacy of China, yet it has a certain level of autonomy left over from it being British. And so right now, as we watch history unfold over the last couple of years, we're seeing whatever transition is going to happen in the relationship between Hong Kong and mainland China. I don't even remember putting all these animations in, but okay, so Federated States, which I think we're probably most familiar with the key players in the world now. You know, these are where you have a central government, but it has a mutual cooperative relationship with subordinate elements of the country. So, you know, what we're most familiar with, the United States and Russia, Mexico, I think has 36 or 38 states. And I would say in Mexico, the states have more autonomy than in the United States. Russia, I don't know enough about the system to say. How do you think that the Russian states or oblasts have in relation to the central government? I have the impression that things are more centralized here. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, well, like formally they have some kind of autonomy, they even have some kind of inner constitution to them, but in fact it's usually like totally centralized. There was a precedent of several oblasts like uniting into a republic in 90s, when it was not that clear how state can be organized and everything was like constructed in different ways. But it was shut down really quick, so no real autonomy.
Yeah. So in the 90s, there must have been this you know, kind of politically fascinating period of reorganization as people decided exactly what the shape of the country was going to be. I'm not sure it came out the way most people wanted it to be, but it does seem to be functioning quite well in many ways. That's weird. Okay, and then the concept of a confederation. Smaller regional governments that hold most of the power, and then you have a weak central authority. So here you see this sort of thing with a lot of these transnational organizations like the European Union or the United Nations. And here we have all these constituent states, but they really hold the power. When the United States wants to thumb their nose at the United Nations, like stopping to contribute funding to the World Health Organization, they just do it and there's no consequence to them. They have no fear of any sort of retribution or exercise of authority or force, coercive force from the United Nations. When Britain decides that they want to leave the European Union, they just do it. And there can be a little bit of economic backlash, but there's no authority for the European Union to hold them together. As compared to the United States, in the 1860s, when the Confederacy attempted to split off from the United States and form their own Confederate States of America, based upon the principle that whites were superior to blacks and therefore they had the inalienable right to own slaves, the United States felt it had the authority to enter into war with the Confederate States to bring them back into the Union. And so even though the Confederate States opened fire first at Fort Sumter, the war that the United States decided to enter into was a test of the federal authority to retain the states as part of the Union, that they had no independent authority to decide to just leave. Whereas the foundation of the Confederacy was the opposite. Their political organization, even though they had a president and vice president, they had a federal authority, but it left in principle, obviously it never got very well developed, but in principle, the states of the Confederate States of America had much more autonomy than was obviously held by the states of the United States of America. All right, so when we think about the organization of the government, you know, we also have to think about the organization of the settlements, the where the people are living. And obviously these things are strongly correlated. When we talk about the federal government, there's a central position where the federal government holds its main office. In the United States, of course, it's Washington, D.C., or Russia, it's Moscow. And there's the organs of the state for management of the state are held in these capitals. But then you go out into these other areas, the other states or oblasts, and you begin to have a relationship that's both a spatial relationship as well as a governmental relationship. And so that's really important to think about, is that what is the relationship between the territorial boundaries of the sub-components of the Union in relation to the federal government. So when we look at ancient societies, the settlement is focused very much on the structure of the cities and the settlement of the people. Before you have the nation states and state boundaries, that your definitions of your boundaries are often the hinterlands associated with a highly populated area. So if you think of Athens, right, what's associated with Athens in its earliest stages are the agricultural lands around it, the port, you know, which was a, you know, a major part of the infrastructure of the city. And so those become the defining aspects of the city-state of Athens. As you get into more complex societies, obviously the dimensions of this get much more complex. If you think of New York City, where does the food come to support the population of, what is the population of New York City, 20 million people? In the greater, as this was referred to in this chart here, a megacity, where does all that those resources come from? It's not from the immediate hinterland around New York City, right? It's from international shippings, it's from trains coming in, it's from planes coming in, you know, as well as local agricultural products. But it's this massive system to bring in enough resources to supply this urban center that has grown and swallowed up all the surrounding urban centers. So when you look at the chart, these mega cities, which I would probably include, you know, New York, Cairo, London, you know, cities like this that have just grown and grown, and they're often defined by all these boroughs that used to be smaller towns and cities that were swallowed up by the expansion, the urban expansion of the mega city. So we can follow that down to metropolis, to conurbation, to city, to get the yellow one, a large town, small town, village, hamlet, isolated dwelling. And of course, the quantity, what the pyramid is trying to show you is that you don't have very many mega cities, right? They're you know, they're kind of unitary centers. And then the farther out you go, of course, you have more and more of these smaller entities till you get out to the very farmlands where it's very much just these isolated dwellings where you have a family living on a farmstead, you know, farming that, and then their resources would then usually move up some sort of logistical chain, whether it's stepwise through various markets or direct transfer to the megacity or to the, you know, to the main market area or through redistribution centers. So you've built the spatial structure that, like I said, has a parallel to the political structure as well. But it is, when you're thinking about the settlement, that's the physical place that people are living as opposed to the political authority that comes from that area. One of the big controversies in the United States right now is that, you know, in the last 20 years or so, we've had two presidents who were elected without a majority of the people voting for them. So George Bush against Al Gore, and then Donald Trump against Hillary Clinton, where Hillary Clinton had 3 million more people voting for her, but he won the Electoral College. And so what you're seeing is that there's a political structure to the voting that's different than the settlement demographic aspect of the voting. So whereas you have more people in New York or California, that the way the system is broken up, that they were not able to get as much representation in the choice of the president because of the territorial distribution of the Electoral College. So, you know, I think that's a nice way to kind of to recognize that there's not a direct correlation between the demography and the political and governmental organization, that it has biases in it, and sometimes very purposeful biases to, you know, deprive or enhance the political power of some people within the state or the country. So one thing is to recognize is that when humans settle on a landscape, it's not arbitrary. We don't, it's not like, you know, entropy in the second law of thermodynamics, right? What does that say? If you had a bunch of particles in a closed sphere, that they would naturally spread out evenly throughout the sphere, right? But humans don't spread out naturally, do we? We group up. And so here, this is just looking at a hierarchy of settlements and looking at the resources, the political resources available at each of these communities. And so, you know, do they have a post office, a hospital, you know, a developed road infrastructure, a large marketplace? And what you look at when you look at this distribution is that you realize that it's very modal. So you'll see that they'll fall into groups, you know, a group of hamlets which have similar structure. You know, in Egypt, you know, it's always a challenge to find a town with a bank teller, a bank, automatic bank machine, right? If I want to withdraw money from a bank. So you move up through this hierarchy, and as you go to larger towns that have more facilities, more services available to the population, right? And so if you look at the graph on the right side here, you'll see, you know, hamlets versus villages versus small towns and larger towns and cities, and then going on up to the capital where you have usually, again, the institutions of the federal government available, or the state government. So when you think of why people break down into these categories, I mean, there's a lot of very pragmatic reasons. Like, you don't want to build a giant hospital in every town because it's just too expensive and it doesn't meet the needs. But people are organized to take advantage of the landscape, the fundamental structure of most of our states and lands is agriculture. And so as people began to settle out and organize into regional units, it was to take advantage of the resources. So there'll be clumped together where they can best optimize the exploitation of those resources. So agricultural community will be spread out, but then there'll be a town where they can go to get their supplies that they need for farming, where there's a marketplace where they can deliver their goods, perhaps a rail junction where they can put the goods to a train. But you're not going to have a rail stop at every town or every hamlet. There's going to be a centralized area, and then they'll distribute spatially around there so that they optimize the use of the land and the distance to that center so that they're not wasting a lot of money or resources to deliver that. And this is a kind of a law in human behavior that we do try, and we think logically when we plan to try to optimize how we live on the landscape and how we do things. When you plan your day going to, you know, to school, when we used to go to the building and stuff, you would think about what's the best way for me to transfer when you're looking for a place to live. In your case, it was the dorms. For me, I was looking for an apartment within walking distance of the SAS. That we tend to think about these things, and that affects where we live in the landscape. And so we optimize our environment to meet the demands of how we're making our living. You can think of circumstances where towns evolve for different purposes. So I mentioned, you know, agriculture being a primary one, but there are other types of economic forces and demographic forces that influence why a town might appear someplace. Give me some examples. Think about why towns appear in certain areas.
As I remember, you said that Rome appeared where it appeared because it was like in this center, in this infrastructural interlayering. So it was simply convenient for them to be there, right?
Well, no, that's almost a little bit backwards. That's why it was in the center of the empire. That's why the empire appeared. Why did Rome appear there? The Tiber River, the Palatine Hills. It was good agricultural land. It had access to the port of Ostia. But as a small city state, when they first, began to grow and settle, the access to Egypt and things weren't as important to them at that stage. There were a lot of other places, other ports in Rome. In Italy or Sicily that had better ports and better access to areas. So that wasn't the primary reason why they would initially settle there. Why the empire was shaped the way it was had everything to do with that. Is anybody from a mining town, for instance? Yeah, I mean, we see towns spring up for mines all the time, extraction of resources other than agriculture. And Gregory, like you mentioned, Rome was in a good place. There are places that grow up human. We have here a river, so I imagine the agricultural lands here are very good. That there was the transition probably to the steppe, so there was also ability to enter into relationships, maybe with nomadic peoples who had different resources. But wasn't this also a terminus on the Silk Road? When Peter the Great settled here, was that economic impetus of being, part of a trade route really important to that initial settlement and why he brought colonists in here?
I actually don't remember the initial setup of the tumen, but as I remember, like it started to grow really fast because of the Trans-Siberia railroad.
Oh yeah, like, sure.
It was just a few kilometers. So it was a choice between Tumen and Tobolsk. So and they were like almost equal at that time. So Tumen had this railroad, and that's why it started to grow but it could be Tobolsk also too.
Yeah, no, yeah, absolutely. And that's a big thing. So here you have this new technology coming in when the railroads were being built. And so you look at a city in America like Chicago, that was a major rail hub. And so that was one of the driving forces for it to grow up as a city. And oftentimes, you know, a railroad passing through an area might cause one town to be abandoned, you know, or shrink, and another town then to grow up as people move to that rail hub because it connected them and allowed them to engage in a lot more trade. So, and you know, ports, as you said, like with Rome, the major port was Ostia. So it's about a half a day's walk from Rome to the coast and the port, or with Athens to the port of Piraeus, which is what the main port that would feed to Athens. So, you know, these cities respond, you know, the human settlement responds to these different types of forces that open up opportunity. And there are these positive feedbacks that happen. You put a railroad through a town, so suddenly the farmers are going to want to be as close as they can to that town so they can get their goods to the railroad station so they can sell them at a lower cost, because it costs money to move them. So the farther away you are, the lower your returns. And then, you know, other businesses move into that town. And so there's this positive feedback that can allow these places to grow into places like New York, which obviously, you know, did grow to be a mega city because of its role as a port and the entry port in particular to the United States. So here's where goods and people were all arriving into the United States from the, you know, dominating the East Coast for all intercourse with the rest of the world. So in this graph is kind of interesting, because here they actually did the studies by looking at the different towns and the different services available. But there are these outliers that happen as well. And it is important to recognize that, you know, it can be because of the initiative of one or a small group of people or a particular business or a particular need that a place starts to develop, that things may not fall exactly into these patterns. But in general, as a general practice, we can see that there is this modal distribution of how people and resources and services will clump together at various scales, moving up a hierarchy to the, you know, again, to the capital, where you expect there to be the highest level of organization. Now, when Washington was chosen as a capital for the United States, does anyone know what the capital was before Washington? Washington, D.C.? So Philadelphia and Pennsylvania. But the other states were a little jealous, you know, because they did not want one state to own the capital of the country. And so they established the District of Columbia, Washington, D.C., as the place of the capital. And Washington, D.C. is not a state. So it's got a separate status. Obviously, it's not the center of the colonies anymore, which were originally only 13 states before America expanded westward. It was more of a central location. But they built it up like that. Now, Brazil has tried to do a similar thing, right, with Brasilia. So it's not uncommon to create these disembedded capitals in order to accommodate the federal sort of competition of the federated states that don't want one state to have the ownership of the capital, which would give them an advantage over the other states in this sort of trying to maintain the equality between the states. So looking at the organization of something like Mesopotamia, and again, here where you're talking originally about these city-state style of governments, where you would have a king, you'd have a series of priests and soldiers, government officials, and then under those would be the merchants and the farmers and the craftsmen, and then below that would be slaves. So you can start to look at the way that, you know, we look at settlement patterns and we look at government, now we look at social hierarchies as well. so that that people are ranked in these organizational layers of a society that we're looking at. You look at the Middle Ages, and you look at the feudal organization, again, where you have a king, and you have your lords and your vassals, and then you have your church, which can fit in various ways as well. And that's something we'll talk a little bit about probably on Thursday, is thinking about some of these organizations that don't necessarily conform to national boundaries or national identities. So if you think of churches, and of course the Roman Catholic Church is one of the best examples that we have because it evolved out of the Roman Empire. How about the relationship between the Roman Catholic Church and England? What did Henry VIII do? Is he famous for? Does anyone know? Yeah, I mean, he got into a beef with the Pope, right? About divorcing his wife, and so he created a new religion, the Church of England, and a Protestant religion. So protesting the authority of the Catholic Church, and creating another religion. So these things can be very plastic and circumstantial, and kings will use them for their authority, but then they will also pervert them or change them to meet their particular needs. And of course, that led to many decades of bloody war in England as they went back and forth with Catholicism. If you think of the Jewish organization, what happens to what is at one point a state religion when the state disappears, but the religion's able to persist, and then didn't really get a state again until 1948 when Israel became a state. But the Jewish state in Palestine, pretty much came to an end in 70 AD when Titus put down the last rebellion that led to the destruction of the temple, which had been the central place of religious authority, and also, again, associated with the state authority in Palestine. There was another Jewish state that did occur north of the Black Sea for a while in the Middle Ages. But in general, you had a disembodied identity using a very diffused form of social, political, and economic organization, but maintained a social identity that carries on to today. So again, just looking at the organization of the Roman Catholic Church with the Pope, cardinals, archbishops, bishops, priests, deacons, and the laity. And what you can start to see is these different formations of governmental organizations, but that can exist either within a national organization or in some sort of transnational form of government. And so when we think about collapse of societies, sometimes I think it's important to think beyond just the state boundaries that we usually tend to think about when we think about collapse. And these, again, can be very highly centralized, like the Mormons or the Catholics, or very decentralized, where you have a very loose sense of authority. Who's the head of the Jewish church? Depends. It's very, it depends what branch of the Jewish faith you might belong to. And the authority seems very diffuse, as far as I know. Whereas if you want to know who's in charge of the Roman Catholic Church, I think everybody knows exactly who it is and where to find them. So you have a much more centralized system versus these decentralized systems. Again, thinking in terms of complexity, this was I thought was an interesting study looking at the complexity in the United States. And by counting up the number of web pages associated with different bureaucratic institutions, and that the higher levels of complexity would have more web pages, more information. So when we talk about some of the characteristics of complexity and the evolution of complex societies, we were talking before about writing and record keeping. Web pages are one of the big measures I think we have of those mechanisms of bureaucracy and complexity that we have. And so this, I think, was a productive way of trying to understand the layering of complexity, looking, you know, down at the state level up to the federal government level. So they looked at, you know, the different U.S. states. You know, they saw that there were 32.5 million public web pages. I mean, that's quite phenomenal when you think about that. Those web pages are all created by public employees for the most part, right? And so you think of the nature of the bureaucratic structure and the economic and political strength of those structures to generate that much data, information, and records for the maintenance of the bureaucracy. I think we can go here and see a little bit more of a hierarchical structure, and then looking at the different elements of the bureaucracy that are represented, you know, from ethics, health, social services, tourism, commerce. So I think last week someone had asked about what is complexity when we're talking about a state. This is a manifestation of complexity. When you understand how much is going on within these bureaucratic organizations, and again, think back to a band level society versus a chiefdom versus, you know, a city state, you know, where we have palatial records often from these city states from the Mycenaean period in Greece or in Egypt. And we have thousands and thousands of records, but when you look at what these complex societies now have, you can see that there's this exponential growth in complexity that goes into these societies. So if you imagine the breakdown of these societies, if your society is starting to break down, do you think that there would be significant decrease in the number of web pages being generated? So could that be used as a measure of understanding the loss of complexity, and could it be abrupt? I, in my previous career, sued the Secretary of Defense in the United States government for sexual harassment of one of my colleagues. So obviously the Secretary of Defense was involved in it, but that's who, you know, through the bureaucracy, that's who is the person who's held responsible in federal court. So that case is in appeal. So it goes to a federal government office, to a federal court of appeals. And there's a bureaucracy that handles it. There's judges who sit in those seats. There's clerks who handle all the bureaucracy. The judges were never appointed by President Trump. So my case is sitting in limbo there. And to me, when I see something like that, I see it as a symptom of the breakdown of the bureaucracy. When these, if you look at this chain over here on the screen, you can imagine these are web pages associated with all these different things, but you can imagine it being any aspect of the bureaucracy. You know, it could be judgeships, it could be, you know, the people who are supposed to work in the, you know, pandemic response team. When those offices aren't filled, when the bureaucracy starts breaking down, things stop happening. And so, you know, that my case has been sitting in appeal for several years, you know, not a real big deal. But if it's a symptom of lots of things that aren't being processed and aren't going through, you're starting to see that these institutions of the bureaucracy, the institutions of the state, aren't working anymore. And are those symptomatic then of collapse? When we look at ancient societies, we're going to be wanting to look at some of these institutions. Where are they failing? Why did the military lose these battles? Why did they lose these territories? Why was there a rebellion in the city? Why was there a slave revolt? These type of things. What was the response to a natural disaster, to Pompeii exploding, or, you know, Mount Vesuvius? You know, how much impact did that have? What did the pandemic do to the economy? You know, and of course, many of these societies faced these type of plagues, much worse than what we're facing by far. And a lot of them didn't really survive as complex societies afterwards, that there was so much damage that the institutions fell apart, that they were no longer able to function. At what point, if we stay in our isolation, you know, does the state stop to function? You look at a place like Syria, you know, that's been in war for so long. At what point do things stop to function? It amazes me, actually. You know, I have a friend in Beirut, and there's some civil unrest going on there now. The economy's shattered, and they're under lockdown for the pandemic as well. How, you know, Lebanon, which is just rebuilding from being a collapsed state, you know, will it be able to maintain its political identity and political structure with all these stresses that are going on there right now? So I think it's important to recognize when we're talking about these things that, you know, even looking at something like web pages are a metric that we can use to understand the nature of complexity and the dynamics of expansion and contraction with these societies, and what might move a society towards that breaking point where it stops to function. So we talked about settlement and some of the reasons for it, you know, being resource exploitation. But there are other things that can happen when a state is distributing the population, or the population is distributing itself on the landscape. So topography can be an issue on it, right? Where people choose to live in certain areas, you know, people, elderly people flocking to Florida because they like the weather, they like the beach. Security, if you feel threatened in a certain area, you might feel vulnerable on the frontier, it'll affect how you're going to live on that landscape. And I'll have you read an article, something I wrote about the frontiers in Mexico during the Aztec Empire. Strategic concerns. It's not unusual, particularly in pre-industrial states, to put populations into particular areas to hold the frontiers. With the Roman Empire, when a soldier retired from the Roman Empire, what were his options? One was to receive a chunk of land on the frontier and to become a ready reserve, and so that the Romans, and other people had done this as well, but the Romans would populate frontier areas with retired soldiers to solidify the security of those frontiers. Resources we talked about, sometimes there's simply a historical precedent, ancestral lands, things that drive you to want to control and settle that land. You think of Aboriginal populations in Australia, that they have ancestral lands, or in some areas of the United States, and I imagine here in Russia as well, where people claim a historical association to that land and want to settle on that land because of that historical association. Trade, we talked about, and then communications and transport, you know, best exemplified, I think, the example I think Gregory brought up about railways, one of the great examples of how that can affect people settling on the landscape. So again, we talked about that idea: in a perfect, sterile environment, that people would distribute evenly on the landscape. And so sometimes when we're looking at settlement patterns, we use a concept called Thesian polygons. So in an ideal homogeneous landscape with people with no history and nothing but resource extraction, we would divide up evenly around the landscape. And so there would be, you know, central areas and then, you know, a series of settlements that optimize the use of the land. And then if there's a hierarchy, then it might break down into these polygons of, you know, geometric, evenly organized people on that landscape. But of course, reality is much more messy than you know, a geometric model that we might make. And so all those factors that we've talked about before, communications and topography and personalities and history and climate and differential resources and access to water, all of these things play into what the real human settlement is on the landscape. Understanding these things when we're looking at ancient landscapes is super important to the archaeologists, because what we see are how people are distributed on the landscape, but they didn't leave us instructions or usually telling us why they settled in that way. So we have to look at the material evidence that they left behind, the relationship, the contextual relationship of how they are settled on the landscape, and the types of things that are appear in the ruins of their settlements to understand what was going on with that society and what were the factors that were playing into why that settlement was eventually abandoned and how it was interconnected to the other settlements within a region. So if you think of, again, using you know, analogy from physics, you know, the law, second law of thermodynamics is the law of entropy, is that people will want to disperse evenly, like that Thesian polygon sort of model, that you disperse to optimize the resources of the landscape. Yet, what a society does is it interjects force, it interjects the opposite of entropy, it interjects some sort of organizing authority and rationale for people to conglomerate into something that is not this, that where we get these urban centers, right? So it's the opposite of entropy, we get negentropy, we get the imposition of other political, economic, social, ideological forces that change our relationship to the landscape compared to what might have happened in the Paleolithic times when hunter-gatherers were distributed on the landscape, that they would probably be distributed fairly evenly according to the resources to minimize competition with each other and to optimize the exploitation of those resources. But as we civilize, all these forces come together and drive us into more nucleated settlements that become central points to our complex societies. Another representation of more ideal settlement patterns without those sort of influences that are the real influences that shape societies. Again, just looking at an idealized model, you know, you can look at the Thesian polygons kind of scattered around with the central points versus what a real topography looks like. And so what the reality, and the people who are looking at Easter Island are going to look at something very similar to this. How does Easter Island divide up into political polygons when the society starts to break down? When things go bad there, how are they divided? How are they fighting over resources? How are they trying to fortify and defend themselves? So when you want to understand that complexity, you're going to have to understand also the relationship to the resources and the topography and how people are settled and why they're settled in those ways. Just an example again of a real model. So here you look at the subunits of political organization that occur in, say, in the Midwest of the United States, where it's broken down into the counties, these smaller political units. So let's see. Okay. The concept of a culture area I want to talk about too. In anthropology, we often group people, and in the normal parlance, when we're talking about peoples, we talk about culture areas. So if I talk about Europeans, Western Europeans, you know who I'm talking about, that it's an area that shares a certain level of cultural affinity. If I talk about Native Americans, that you have, you know, a very large group of, say, you know, what we're called Indians in America, but that can be subdivided into other culture areas, such as Plains Indians or the Northwest Coast. When I talk about the Kwakiutl, that you know, that's one tribe within a constellation of tribes that live in that area and have similarities in how they live. So, actually, let's get someone to read this. Ekaterina, do you want to read these bullet points?
Okay, a geography with one relatively homogeneous human activity or complex of activities, culture, often associated with an ethno-linguistic group and the territory it inhabits, often do not limit their geographic coverage to the borders of a nation state or to smaller subdivisions of a state. And the last one, cultural spheres of influence may also overlap or form concentric structures of macro cultures encompassing smaller local cultures.
So yeah, so if we think about a culture area that like I mentioned for North America, so you can see that there's a large environmental factor that associates with people. If you think of Russia, if you think of the peoples who live in the Arctic Circle, Laplanders and reindeer herders, that they share certain economic activities. They share, you know, usually they have some sort of historical association, even if they've subdivided into various different groups that may start to diverge linguistically, that they still maintain a relationship, that they're often connecting and maybe overlapping, so it may not be hard boundaries between one tribe and another tribe, that those can be softer cultural boundaries. So here, you know, in America, you can see that, you know, the people who live up in the Arctic, obviously very dispersed, decentralized population, because the economics, subsistence of the area doesn't allow people to nucleate into large groups, right? Because they're hunting and gathering. They're using very large areas of lands to collect enough resources to supply a small population. Subarctic, you know, a little bit better in those regards. You have more seasonality that can allow a little bit more diversity of the resources and a little bit denser populations, but really not till you get down into the lower latitudes that you start to see, you know, much more opportunity for complex societies to form based on the culture areas and exploitations. The plains in the United States, before the coming of the horses that came with the Europeans, these were very sparsely populated. It was a very difficult area for people to live in without horses. Once the horses came, it was a lot easier to, you know, to follow the buffalo herds and to take advantage of the larger area. Otherwise, people tended to live on the fringes in a lot of areas of the plains, where they could take advantage of the plains resources but still have access to other agricultural resources and river valley resources. The Southwest, we talked a little bit about the Calusa before as one of the centralized Native American chiefdoms down here that was focused on taking advantage of the Gulf Coast fishing. The Kwakiutl up here in the Northwest, where you had these very rich fishing resources and the salmon runs with the salmon that would seasonally be available in vast quantities. California, which never really developed a lot of complex levels of societies, there at the chiefdom level, even though it was very rich in resources and agricultural resources, but there was an intensive agriculture being practiced there. People tended to use more seasonal migration systems. Same thing with the Great Plains basins. You start getting to the Southwest and then down into Mesoamerica, and here you start to see much more centralized societies beginning to evolve before European contact. So you have the Anasazi, you know, these the Pueblo builders in the Southwest, or get down into Mexico, where you have the development of full-blown empires, highly centralized states with established bureaucracies and the trappings that we associate with these super complex societies. And there was, you know, a series. It wasn't just the Aztecs, for instance. You have the Aztecs and the Tarascans and the city of Tenochtitlan and Monte Alban, and you know, then you can go down into the Maya area and the city-states of the Maya. So you see that there's these culture areas where they share attributes, and it blends into the political organization as well, into the culture area. So there was established in Mexico a tradition of large complex societies fairly early, you know, beginning, you know, with the Olmec, really, by about 1200 BC, the same time that we're talking about the collapse of the Bronze Age in the Eastern Mediterranean, that you start to see these really centralized chiefdoms. And then by the time you get to the period after Christ, you start to see more complex states and then eventually empires appearing up in these areas. Again, certain shared attributes. There are linguistic similarities sometimes, certain cultural and religious ideologies that are repeated across culturally. So the culture area, I think, is an important concept to understand, particularly when we think of some of these transnational forces that appear in conjunction with these states. So we mentioned Europe is a culture area where there's certain shared values and history and linguistics. And then they're building now these transnational identities with the European Union. The United Nations still has a central part of Europe, and overlaid again with some of these European religious traditions, such as Protestantism, Lutheranism, or the Church of England, or the Roman Catholic faith, and now Islam has a much bigger share of Europe as well. So you see these transitions and these transnational forces overlapping with these modern state forces. So when we think about societies, and sometimes we think about the resilience of societies to collapse, I think it's important to think about the culture area complex as an idea, and how that might create an identity that might be able to mitigate or persist beyond the collapse of a complex society. I'm going to skip up. This is just thinking about looking at real settlement patterns again. Here you see the Mycenaean period of Greece, so the Bronze Age of Greece, and you can see these city-states and then other settlements that form up around them. So here Mycenae, the namesake of the culture area, Mycenae, and then all sorts of other settlements that grow up around it. But these tend to be palatial complexes that then would have supporting hinterlands, both with agriculture and herding peoples who would support the central state. We'll talk a lot about the Mycenaeans later when we get to the collapse of the Bronze Age. They're kind of the central player in this. Looking at the Maya low, or the Yucatan Peninsula in particular, but understanding the scope of settlement that's occurring in the Yucatan, particularly the area that we'll talk most about during this course is the Maya lowlands, where you see the rise of these extremely complex monumental kingdoms, some expanding into imperial status, and then a fairly rapid, over 100 or 200 year period, decline to complete abandonment of the population in these areas, which is, when we talk about collapse, it doesn't get much more dramatic than, you know, empty temples in the middle of a jungle. It's like, how did someone come to build all of these things, and then why did they just leave them? Just to give you an example, if you look at the, you know, probably the most famous of the Maya cities from the Maya lowlands, Tikal, and this is, you know, on the left, this is what it looks like today. Overgrown with forest, you know, these temples have been cleaned and reconstructed, so you can see them sticking out of the forest now, but it gives you an idea of the scope of the monumental architecture. And then on the right, this is a recent data within the last, really within the last 10 years or less, that we've been able to collect topographical data through the forest canopy. And this is done by using a laser scanner, LIDAR. And to get through the canopy, what we're able to do is send enough beams that some of those beams are able to send a signal back through the forest that allow us to do a topographical reconstruction underneath the forest. So it's not that they're penetrating the leaves, but you send down enough beams of laser energy to get enough reflection back to be able to do a reconstruction of the surface of the ground below the forest. So what you can see, if you compare on the left where the temples are standing out, on the right with the laser, you can see the roads, what the Maya would call a sacbé, which is a paved pavement of roadway connecting different areas for both ritual purposes, but also just based for communication. You can see the level of settlement, the features associated with water management are all appearing. And you see the emphasis on settlement up on the higher areas, leaving the lower areas for agricultural exploitation. So here, if you look at the site of Naptun, and again, this data has just been collected within the last 5 years, really, that we're starting to get this level of settlement knowledge of the Maya. And so here, down in what would be called the lowland area, or the in Spanish, the Bajo, you see a lot of evidence of what looks like agricultural canals to me. So here, they're exploiting these lowlands. Up in the highland areas, the hilltops, that's where you start to have your temples. And then you can see your settlement hierarchy spreading out off into the distance here. And you'll see in the Maya area, you'll have your central acropolis, right, your main city. And then you'll have like a feudal arrangement where you'll have someone who's subject to that central acropolis. Usually there's some sort of clan association to the king. They'll have a smaller palace complex, and then you'll go out into your smaller settlements. So you might have three or four levels of settlement hierarchy out there. The one that tends to be most invisible, of course, is the peasant who's just farming in a wooden house, you know, with just a very, usually they'll make just a low platform, and then it would be very difficult to see without, you know, more detailed archaeological work. Although the LIDAR is changing our ability to study these sort of settlement patterns. So what I want you to see out of this is the way in which archaeologists begin to try to reconstruct the society. So as we, with the Maya, now we're able to read the writing, so we know the names of the kings, we know the names of the cities, we know who's conquering who and who might be paying tribute to who. Based on the inscriptions that they left on stone. They did write on paper, but not very much of that survived, and the few that we do have tend to be religious in nature. The Spanish destroyed a lot of their writing when the Spanish got there. And then the environment just doesn't allow for the bark paper that they used to write on to survive. But fortunately, they carved a lot of their political information in stone. So we do have very good information about the political histories of some of these areas. And again, when you think about the legitimacy and authority of these kings, that carving on stone was a way of putting up a public billboard saying, I'm the king, you know, and here's my history and here's why I'm legitimately the king. Many times talking about their ancestors, why they have that authority based on their ancestral relationship to the founder of that dynasty, of that city. Questions?
Yes, please. Jay, so we said that there is a tendency for people to group up. So the settlement is like not equal. So I would like to ask you, what would be the motivation, or like what is the motivation for drawing these straight borders on the map, for example, which we can see in the US? So in Russia, the borders are like natural, so to say. So they're repeating the landscape sometimes. And also they're like forming around groups of people. So what is the motivation for straight borders, if there is like any particular?
Yeah, I mean, I think the primary divide is natural divisions, given those opportunities. So people will naturally, you know, you'll want to be on one side of the river or one side of the mountains. And so those become a defensive or resource boundary. With the United States, it's a really good question when you look at the nature of some of the borders, where you have no idea that you've crossed from one state to another, you know, except that there might be a signpost that's saying that you've now entered, you know, Wyoming or you know, or South Dakota. You would otherwise have no idea that you crossed a boundary or border. A lot of that just has to do with political history, how territories were marked out. So when people in the frontier were, you know, drawing maps for people in Washington, that those maps became fixed then into boundaries based on historical and local political dynamics. Some might have, you know, been related to also, you know, how people were relating to Native Americans at the time or to Mexico, you know, when lands were seized from Mexico or purchased from France, like the Louisiana Purchase, when the United States bought that big part of the southern United States on the Gulf Coast from France, so that Napoleon could finance his wars in Europe. He sold that off. You know, those were arbitrary boundaries. Oftentimes, I think it's a sign of colonialism, where just like when we talk about the Middle East being carved up the way it is, not based on natural boundaries, but because somebody was sitting in London, you know, with a ruler and a pencil and decided to carve it up that way because that's how they thought it should be. You know, so I think there's a great deal of arbitrariness to that, just historical accident, really. So not a good answer. You know, we like, you know, the mechanical answers. We like to look at the landscape like we see it in Nocturne and say, okay, people are living, you know, up on top because it's drier and because it doesn't use up maybe good agricultural land, whereas they can then, you know, use the lands surrounding it, the hinterlands, to provide the food to support the denser population in the upland area. But yeah, sometimes it is just a historical accident why a boundary ends up where it does. There is another factor that we didn't really talk about, which is diversification of resources. We talked about someone going after mining or farming. There are a lot of circumstances where territorial boundaries are formed to diversify the resources available so that you would have a piece of bottom land where you have good agriculture and a piece of toe slope where you would be able to grow different crops and a piece of highland which might be better for settlement and maybe a piece of mountaintop where there's other resources available. So when you look at political organization in Peru, for instance, or Chile, as you move down from the Andy Mountains towards the coast, sometimes you'll see that the political organizations tend to be these slices that go down the topography and that they'll start up very high elevation and be a political unit going all the way down towards the coast. And those political units then were able to exploit a wider range of diversified resources. And so it's those interconnections that they had in being able to trade and exchange those resources that allowed these people along these different ecozones to form a political relationship based on that diversity of resources rather than the monopoly of one type of resource. Other questions? That was a good comment. So we talked about Rome and the development of Rome, and we'll spend a little bit of time with that because as we talk about empires and get to empires, Rome, of course, is really the epitome. It's kind of the baseline of what an empire is. It's where we first get the Latin terms. You know, we have that transition from a republican government to an imperial government, right? It happens with the death of Julius Caesar and the rise of Octavian. So it's a nice way to contrast the evolution of other states and empires. We can, the more we understand about Rome, the more we have something to compare to the evolution and de-evolution of other complex societies. So, of course, Rome, you know, beginning in the 6th century BC, begins to develop as a city-state. And then it begins to accumulate territories as a republic. And one of the things that when we think about this is why does a city-state like Rome, you know, originally starting out as a series of villages and settlements on these hills that eventually unite into Rome and then begin to incorporate other city-states in Italy and then eventually outside of Italy, what leads the state into that sort of trajectory of becoming an empire? So first, what is an empire? And let's ask, Daria, do you want to read this?
Which one?
You.
Okay. An empire is a sovereign state functioning as an aggregate of nations or people that are ruled over by an emperor or another kind of monarch or a sovereign state. The territory and population of an empire is commonly of greater extent than the one of a kingdom.
Okay. So when we think about an empire, it's different than a federation, right? It's got elements of that, but it's a centralized authority that's extending its political rule and political control over other entities that were originally independent. And these could be other entities, could be states, but they could also be decentralized people. We'll skip that one. So some of the characteristics of an empire are, Andre, you want to just read off these characteristics of an empire?
All right. Usually multiple ethnic and linguistic groups, usually a recognition of citizenship and different levels of citizenship. Multiple strategies for integration, both social, economic, political, and ideological. And subjugation provinces play a role in the military strategic organization of the empire.
So So as these states are accumulating these different sub-states within them, or pure polity competitions, you know, political entities, there's various motivations that might go into it, and various strategies and tactics that are used to secure them within the realm of that empire. And so that includes the use of social, you know, economic, political, and ideological power. Oftentimes there's issues of citizenship, and of course the evolution of citizenship in Rome is a fascinating topic in and of itself, with citizenship being used as a way to encourage people to want to be Roman. So the people who were conquered eventually are able to get citizenship, whereas originally only the Romans were the citizens and the other people were subjected to them. So you can see that the empire adds in a whole extra layer of political, social, and economic stratification to the complexity of a society, with the empire being the highest level of complexity that, you know, we can yet imagine on Earth. I shouldn't say imagine, that we have yet realized on Earth. We do have these transnational organizations, but they don't tend to layer in as much complexity. They tend to be very targeted for very specific functions. And so they don't hold that level of stratification and complexity that an empire does. They have to deal with a lot of issues such as being multi-ethnic. So, when you think of, in my office and at the SAS, I have a map of different ethnicities, the old National Geographic map of different ethnicities in Russia. And the number of ethnicities encompassed in Russia is amazing. So here's all these different people who brought, many different languages together, many different cultures, spanning several culture areas from Europe to Asia, all within one imperial structure. And so what are the strategies that hold that together? And again, when you understand what holds it together, you also understand what can break down to lead it to break apart and lead towards that concept of collapse. So if you look at the Roman Empire, which I'll use repeatedly here, you can see the growth of it. And really, there's never been anything quite like it since. Here the very northern extent of the Roman Empire in England at Hadrian's Wall, from down to Egypt. That transition that goes from it being a republic, where there is conquest and expansion going on. There are kind of ad hoc imperial administrations. There's the creation of client states and buffer zones. So as we think about the structure of these very complex societies, we want to understand how the processes that these external areas are being integrated into the empire, and how purposeful, how much of it is part of the ideology of the state to conquer and incorporate these places. With the Republic, a lot of times you feel like it just kind of happened. They didn't mean it to happen, but they got involved in a war. There was some sort of competition. Maybe they were afraid or a threat. And in self-defense, they conquered their neighbor, and suddenly they had an empire. So it wasn't that there seemed to be this imperial ideology that we're going to build something that was sometimes referred to as the Pax Romana, the peace of Rome over the world, that instead it seems to happen incrementally. And then in 31 BC, with Augustus defeating Mark Antony in Egypt, it solidifies the imperial identity of Rome and the transference of political organization as well as aspects of the settlement. So now you have more institutionalized processes of maintenance and consolidation, and the imposition of governors within regions, imperial administration, and limes. Anyone know what limes are? So these fortified frontiers that begin to define the political boundaries of the empire in very real terms, like Hadrian's Wall, for instance. So again, you know, from the Republic, you know, where they picked up much of this at the end of the Punic Wars, and that's really where you see Rome begin to take on the imperial characters after the Punic Wars and the defeating of Carthage in the war, after the Third Punic War, around the second, right at the turn of the second to first century BC. And they gained things like Spain, Sardinia, you know, all of Sicily, North Africa, as part of the booty, the territorial booty, you know, of defeating Carthage. And then Rome gets involved with the Hellenistic kingdoms in the Eastern Mediterranean, and expands its influence into Syria, into Asia Minor, into Egypt. By the second century BC, you know, Egypt is functioning pretty much as a client of Rome, even though they hadn't conquered it or formally incorporated it, but that the Ptolemies, including Cleopatra, who had relationship with both Julius Caesar and Mark Antony, you know, it's functioning there. The kings of Egypt, or the pharaohs of Egypt, routinely might go to Rome. Ptolemy the 12th, Cleopatra's father, was exiled to Rome until he got the Romans to come back and help him defeat his daughter, who he executed and retook Egypt. You know, the Israelites, the kingdoms of Judea were incorporated, were also functioning clients of the Romans by the second century BC. And they were then busy helping Rome against the Syrians, the Seleucid Empire, another one of the Hellenistic empires from the time of Alexander the Great. Leftover. And so by the time you get to the imperial period, now they're functionally an empire. They have an imperial ideology that fosters the conquest and incorporation of the goal being the world into becoming Rome. Everybody should be part of Rome in the end. And so they're expanding their influence formally with very rigid bureaucratic structures throughout the European and Mediterranean world. I think we'll end with just a little movie scene, which I think kind of talks about this transition from Julius Caesar into, as Rome evolves into an empire, and this scene between Julius Caesar and Cleopatra the VII, and that is the tomb of Alexander the Great. That was in Alexandria.
That first time when you stood here alone, why did you cry? Will you tell me now?
Because I had lost something.
What?
A lifetime. Mine.
Nonsense.
Having conquered the world, he died at 32. I am 52. My remaining ambition is to keep the world from conquering me.
Your ambitions must always have been his. They still must be.
Should I tell you something? When I was 32 in Spain, I came upon a statue of Alexander. I wept then too. Even then.
I want you to have his soul to take back with you.
Too deeply embedded.
It can be removed.
It's buried in time.
Then Alexander is mine.
Too heavy for Caesar.
His dream now. Make his dream yours, Caesar. His grand design. Pick it up where he left off. Out of the patchwork of conquest, one world, not a one world, one nation, one people on earth living in peace.
So you have told me at last what it is you want of me.
Of us.
In the center, the capital of this one world, one people, one nation, Alexandria.
He chose it.
I am Rome.
He was Greek. What will it matter when we're all one people?
I am 52. He was 32 and failed.
We will succeed. Your dreams, your ambitions.
One lifetime is not enough for such dreams and such ambitions.
The cloak of Alexander cannot be too heavy for Rome and Egypt to carry together. And what if his sword is too deeply embedded? Yours will replace it, Caesar.
You have a way of mixing politics and passion. Where does one begin and the other leave off?
That did not start, nor will it end with me.
Cleopatra, whatever it is, however it comes out, leave me my destiny.
Your destiny is no longer just you. It's light. Soon there will be someone to carry both the cloak of Alexander and the sword of Caesar. And the name of Caesar. And in that name, he will rule Egypt and whatever part or all of the world that we give him. Our child will be a son for you, Caesar. By Isis, I swear it. Could you put off your return to Rome just long enough?
So when you look at a scene like that, which is amazingly accurate in a lot of ways as far as the description of the tomb of Alexander the Great, where he was encased in a crystal tomb filled with honey and that his body was kept in there. You see the concept of empire being articulated between these two leaders. And a lot of times, empire happened because of individual personalities and the fate of these individuals. Her child, Caesarion, of course, named after a C-section, C-section named after Caesarion, was eventually murdered by Octavian. She had a daughter also with Mark Antony, and her daughter went on to marry, was taken back to Rome, raised by Mark Antony's widow, and then she was eventually married in a political marriage to one of the governors of North Africa. And that would have been the last we know of Cleopatra's line. But had Caesar not been assassinated, had the Cleopatra and Mark Antony not lost the war to Octavian, to Augustus, the fate and the shape of the world could have been very different. And so empire is something that it's not an inevitable evolution. It's something that happens because of a set of circumstances and a set of people involved in it. When Mussolini took control of Italy, he had a dream and a vision of recreating the Roman Empire with Italy in under fascism. Obviously a man not capable in many ways of trying to enact that, but it was still a concept that he had for the Italian state. And so as Italy entered into its imperial phase under fascism, starting with in Africa with Ethiopia, for instance, and then trying, rather poorly to conquer Greece, which he was defeated and had to call on Hitler to send forces to help him to eventually conquer Greece. His forces were driven back to Albania, which was an Italian colony at that point. So, but it was still the concept of building some sort of empire that he had and tried and failed miserably at, and was eventually murdered by his own people. So it's as anthropologists and archaeologists, we look at the complexity and the patterns of the development of states and empires, But I think we have to also keep into mind that while we look at these mechanical aspects of the relationship of settlement pattern, of economic development, of all these things that go into it, that these things can be also driven in a particular direction by the personalities of people involved in positions of leadership or positions of rebellion against the authorities. So there's nothing mechanical or inevitable about the fate of what the world is going to look like. It's a matter of decisions that are made by people acting as agents within the context of these mechanical aspects of complex society that we live and work in. And I think we're at our time for today. Any last questions or comments? All right. Thank you. We have a makeup course for Friday, don't we? Also, were you guys notified of when that is? I think it's Wednesday, but I'm not sure what time yet. So we have our seminar, but I think we'll have our group work from last Friday on Wednesday also. As soon as I hear back from Aliona, I'll put an announcement up on campus on that. Any other last questions? Yep, or two?
Well, there are two classes on Wednesday in the schedule in 10:40 and 12:30.
Okay. All right. I thought she had put it to Wednesday. I didn't receive a notification, but you guys have it on Modius, I assume, which I don't have. So, okay. It wasn't on my calendar, but that's perfect. So we start at 10:40 on Wednesday, and we'll just go all the way through into the group work. A lot of what we're focused, we'll talk a little bit about Zotero. Who's been using Zotero already? Anybody? All right, so we'll do a little workshop on Zotero. Try to get it downloaded on your computers. There's a desktop application, and then there's also the web application, like most things nowadays, like Zoom. And then for each of the groups, you're going to want to set up a folder, a share folder, to put your shared resources in. You guys will be amazed at how easy it'll make your lives as far as managing bibliographies and references and coordinating your use of resources. We'll go over that with the seminar and group work on Wednesday. But do take a look at it if you have time between now and then. You have the readings, of course. I'll get your grades back on your other readings. As long as you put the effort in, it's mostly just a pass-fail sort of situation. So have a great day, and I will see you on Wednesday.
Jay, I have a question about our assignment.
Yes.
About preliminary analysis report. It is written in the description that we should submit it by the end of week 4. And the deadline is on 9th of May.
Did I push it up too fast? Let me take a look at that. I'll let you know on Wednesday, but yeah, I'm not opposed to pushing that later. I got rid of the midterm, mm-hmm. So I did adjust the schedule a little bit. I got rid of the midterm and I added an individual assignment on there. So if you saw the changes on the announcements and the assignments. So let me take a look at that. Do you guys think that that's too soon? Do you need more time to develop your preliminary?
Okay. Yeah, I think, yeah.
The question is also that we have our additional readings and at the same time we have to do our reading notes and that is too much, I guess.
Okay. Okay, I'll adjust the deadlines. We'll add another week on there for each of those other reports that are due then. Dory?
Jay, I also wanted to ask, could you please post readings for notes just a little bit earlier, you know, to more manage, make it more manageable.
Okay. Yeah, I did publish, I think I published the an extra week ahead on Saturday. So I put this week's and the next week's up. I hope I did. Maybe I forgot to hit publish. So yeah, I'll try to stay at least a week ahead. I'm going to adjust some of the readings depending on outside speakers that we have coming in. So let me talk to Eric Klein, for instance, and see if you know, he wants something read. I did. Shoklo was able to find a copy of his book on the collapse of the Bronze Age in Russian. So I will make that available if I can. And if there's an assignment out of that book, that way you can read it in Russian, which might make it a little bit easier for you. You know, I know we want you to read as much in English as possible, but I think it's kind of nice. He's proud of the fact that the book's been published in Russian, so I think it's would be nice to be able to read it in the Russian edition.
Yeah, may I ask two more questions?
Yeah.
I think that guys are allowed to left, right? They don't need to listen. That is about our assignment. So the first thing is, should we divide the parts equally in our assignment? Or, for instance, the parts about language will be smaller than the parts about social and political situation in the civilization?
It's probably better to do it topically for you guys, just so you don't have to try and think, well, I'm going to write half a paragraph on this, and you know, and that way I've written 12 lines and you've written 12 lines. So focus on the topics, you know, put in the extra research time, you know, find the extra sources on it. If someone's section seems too easy, then maybe they can do some extra research as far as, you know, some...
The question is just about the word count. Like, should it be equal on each part, or some parts should be more elaborated than another?
Oh, you mean with the final paper?
Preliminary analysis as well. So I mean that, for instance, information about language is not so popular than about political and social order. And here, is it important to them to be equal or not?
No, for the group assignment, you guys work that out. I will ask you to do, I think, like we did in Global Issues last time, where I'll ask you to rate the participation of people in the group just in case there's someone who's not really working hard. And you guys are the only one.
Okay, can I try one more time?
Yeah.
Like, we have an assignment for 2,500 words, right?
Yeah.
And there are five stages, like language, then socio-political order, and other. And so my question is, should we divide these 2,500 words equally?
Or, no. Mm-hmm. Okay. One thing, let me just say goodbye to anyone who's streaming out from outside, because we're kind of dealing with internal issues for the class. Thank you for your attention. If you have questions, you can send those through, and Sharko will pass those on to me. I'll be glad to answer anything. So let me say, you know, goodbye to those who are streaming, dosvidanya, and then let me get back with Asya on this. Okay. So it's not.